Welcome. I'm up here for two reasons here at lunchtime. First, to introduce a really exciting new community program to empower women and girls, and more importantly, to introduce our lunchtime speaker, Dr. Denise Dunning. Dr. Dunning's remarks are really the most important part of this lunch. So I'm going to give you a pretty quick rundown overview of our community program with the promise that, sorry, I forgot to pick up my clicker, with the promise that as the weeks and months go by, you'll hear more about it and feel more aware and included in it. So we've heard this morning, and we'll hear more today and tomorrow, about Cummins' efforts to increase diversity and inclusion inside of Cummins. Now I want you to set your sights on the women and girls outside of Cummins. I'd like for you to think about the women and girls who live among us, but apart from us. The women in the villages that we see in the distance as we walk into our beautiful manufacturing plants. The women we see walking, oftentimes barefoot, along the sides of the road, carrying sticks or water for cooking. The girls who live in our slums, who walk to school in their uniforms, often in great danger, as we ride past them in our cars to work. The girls who crowd onto benches in public schools, schools that look very different from the schools where we send our kids. The schools that often don't have bathrooms with running water or privacy for adolescent girls. The schools that are all too often left behind by those girls as they fade into the obscurity of early childbirth and housework. The child brides, handed over into marriage to much older men, the women and girls who long ago forgot how to laugh. The women who clean our houses, our corporate offices, our hotel rooms, after we leave. The women who take care of our children when we go to work and then go to their own homes for many, many more hours of unpaid work, cooking, cleaning, and taking care of their own children. Children who they love as deeply as we love our children and for whom they have aspirations that look just like our aspirations for our children. Sometimes these girls are our sisters, our wives, our mothers, our friends, but usually not. Some of them are women and girls who help power our economies, but they're invisible to us. More often than not, they are not in our economies at all. They have spent their lives at home, raising children and doing housework as their brothers and their husbands continue their education, acquire skills, and go into the paid workforce. These are women who do not have this great company as their advocates and protectors, and they do not have you as their managers and mentors. These are women for whom the Me Too movement is the faraway words of a very different world. Why is it important to the strength of our communities to bring these women into our economies and into our world? Very simply, when women as half of a community are doing paid work, GDPs rise. And when the GDP of a community or economy goes up, it's not only good for women, it's good for the community. There is money then for education. There's money for healthcare. There's money for infrastructure. Okay? As importantly, women tend to spend their own income on the household, on the children, thereby preparing the next generation for education and work. There are moments of transformational change that hinge on a moment of pivotal, intense action that helps turn the tide of human rights. Two great examples. One, in the international community, standing hand in hand with Africans in their ferocious struggle, their ferocious internal opposition to white minority rule in South Africa, helped turn the tide of apartheid. In 1963, here in the United States, the grassroots March on Washington was the fundamental impetus for the passage of the Civil Rights Act in 1964. I think that right now, we are on the cusp of transformational change for women and girls around the world. I do. As a leading advocate for women said recently, the rights of women and girls are the unfinished business of the 21st century. But what is the role of a company like Cummins, or any single private actor, in transformational change? You might think, with or without Cummins, we kind of feel it, we kind of think it's going to happen, we think change is a-coming. But can we stand by and wait to help the women and girls most in need in our communities? I think not. I think, though, with Cummins leadership, we can assuredly accelerate change. Many times now, we've seen how the brave, caring voice of Cummins can make a difference. And that strong, ethical, brave, and respected voice, when heard, can act as a guiding light for other companies. And so, Cummins leads. We're launching a new community program to empower women and girls all over the world. It's our single most ambitious community program ever, and we're calling it Cummins Powers Women. Let me give you a bit of background on Cummins Powers Women. We've thought about this issue deeply for a long time now. Our leadership team's final decision to start a program empowering women and girls actually was made in December 2016. And after that moment, we put so much time into it, researching the problems affecting women and girls, looking into the solutions, researching the best nonprofit experts in the world who had time-tested programs, who had tried and failed, had determined the right metrics to intervene in women and girls. Then we went to talk to the experts. Our leadership team went to talk to the experts. We looked at their programs. We interviewed them. We thought the program should be leader-led at Cummins to complement our excellent, wonderful employee engagement work that's been in place for many years and will be going nowhere. We wanted to have global reach. We wanted to make sure our leadership teams had an expert nonprofit that was knowledgeable about their regions to work with on local problem solving. We asked every regional leader personally, will you sponsor this work? Yes. Will you assign two champions on your leadership team, not the corporate responsibility leader, your leaders, to champion this work and drive it forward? Yes. And then we invested. We invested our foundation funding in these experts in women and girls empowerment, and we put together a program. Just to give you an example of how committed everyone is, on the Cummins leadership team alone, Maria Rose, Mark Osowick, Sherry Aholm, Tom Linebarger, Rich Freeland, Sharon Barner, Tracy Embry, and many more said, I want to personally be involved in this. Personally. In fact, we were a little bit nervous. We're like, what are we going to do with all of them? I mean, they're all so invested in this. So let me give you a little sense of what the whole world looks like in this program. In North America, we're partnering with Girls Inc., which has a really extensive footprint all over the country. In Latin America, Ignacio Garcia and Luis Pascuato will work with Rise Up. In Europe, Antonio Leitao's team will work with Rosa in the United Kingdom and Save the Children in Germany. The Save the Children program will empower refugee women and girls. In Africa, Gina Butera's team will work with Rise Up and CAMFED. In India, Sandeep Sinha's team will work with Rise Up. In China, Steve Chapman's team will work with the China Women's Development Foundation to empower rural women. And in Asia Pacific, Peter Jensen Muir and his team will work with Girls Academy in Australia and CARE in Cambodia. In the coming months and years, these teams will identify projects in the work already being performed by these expert nonprofits and help them solve problems, use the vast array of leadership skills that exist on these teams to work with the nonprofit to improve their work and empower girls and women. As our leadership teams begin working, we'll share stories, share knowledge across nonprofits, share knowledge across regions, and work towards a more full program. We hope that our community involvement teams and other employee teams will strengthen the work that they're already doing with women and girls, and will begin new programs to empower women and girls. Not only will our leadership teams and community involvement teams be involved, we hope we all play a role in the empowerment of women and girls around the world. On your own, make the invisible visible. Step up safely as a bystander when you see harassment, discrimination, abuse. See the women and girls among us and understand their lives and their problems. Inspire and lead Cummins Powers Women. Let's get started together and finish the unfinished business of the 21st century. Thank you.
One of the biggest reasons that I joined Cummins was because of the culture. Yes, we're a diesel company, we're a manufacturing company, but we're actually very forward-thinking. I really am passionate about Cummins being known for what it does for empowering women and actually helping to rise women up in our community.
Women who are empowered in the sense that they have access to education, they have access to health care, they have access to the ability to work. They create a community that is stronger than for women who don't have that.
The Cummins Powers Women program provides an answer to the cry for help from millions of women and girls around the world who are in dire need for someone to stand up and address the plight that they face.
How do you make the communities that you live in, you work in, better? And therefore, how do you make society a little bit better? How can we really look at women's empowerment and say, how can we make a difference? There's a responsibility to do this, and it makes us a better company.
The reason Cummins exists in the first place is to make people's lives better by powering a more prosperous community. I strongly believe that the Cummins Powers Women initiative allows us to hold a mirror to ourselves and what we're doing internally at Cummins and reflect that on our communities.
The important question for each leadership team that leads at this company is, what do you want your legacy to be? And so our leadership team did a lot of thinking about that. I'd like to make an impact on making the world a more just place for women and girls. It clearly is not today. It's making an engine's hard, making the world more just for women and girls is bigger. Our Women and Girls Initiative, it's different. We are launching it as a top-level initiative for the company at large.
We worked really hard to find nonprofit partners around the world who had research-based programs, metrics in place, and a really strong track record of engagement with women and girls. From on-the-ground mentoring and teaching of women and girls, all the way up to leadership development and advocacy at a regional level. And all of these programs we're putting together in a global program that Cummins is supporting.
We want to do this across the company, and we want our leadership team to be directly engaged in this big initiative so we can have a bigger, more sustainable, and long-lasting impact.
Wanting to be part of this program isn't just a personal piece. This isn't all about Sherry's a female and therefore it makes sense for her to be involved in this. I think there's also a lot for women and men to come together and actually talk about these issues.
I'm now a father of a 9-year-old girl. I want my daughter to have every opportunity as she goes into the future. I look forward to a world where she can be anything that she wants to be.
I was raised in a family of mostly girls where gender was never an issue, where my parents looked at me as an empowered person and told me that I could have whatever I wanted to if I worked hard for it. And I want every girl in the world to have the same opportunity that I had, to not look at gender at all in terms of a barrier, but to only see the opportunities that exist in the world.
We've never done something as big and global as this on one topic. So what I'd like to ask you as leaders to do is lead on this initiative for women and girls empowerment in the same way that you would lead any other business initiative of Cummins. Let me count on you to make a difference in this area. I know that we can make the world a better place as a result.
Now that we've introduced Cummins Powers Women to you, it's time to introduce you to our distinguished speaker, Dr. Denise Dunning. Not yet, I haven't introduced her. I've got to introduce her. Dr. Dunning is an expert in women and girls empowerment. She's the founder and executive director of Rise Up, which advances health, education, and equity for women and girls globally. Rise Up is one of our global Cummins Powers Women partners, and Dr. Dunning will tell you about Rise Up's work in more detail in just a minute. As for Dr. Dunning herself, she's a complete and total rock star. She teaches at the University of California. She has a PhD in sociology from the University of California, Berkeley, a master's in public affairs from Princeton University, and graduated summa cum laude from Duke University. She's worked for the David and Lucille Packard Foundation and the Rockefeller Foundation. She was a Fulbright scholar and is the recipient of many awards. Her work has been featured by the New York Times and many other publications. Of course, she speaks 4 languages. We've asked her to speak to us today in English. We're most proud to say that Dr. Dunning and Rise Up are key partners in Cummins Powers Women.
What if you had the power to create exponential change? Imagine that just for a minute. What if Cummins had the ability to create a more just and a more equitable world? I'm going to tell you a secret. You do. And I'm going to tell you how. But first, I'm going to tell you a story. It's my story. My mom is from Argentina, and growing up, I used to spend a lot of time there as a child. And one year, when I was 12, we were there for the Christmas holidays, and we had been invited by family friends to come spend Christmas Eve in their home. So we're on a train, leaving Buenos Aires, heading out into the suburbs, and about 20 minutes outside the city, the train doors opened, and a girl stepped onto the train. She was a couple years older than me. Maybe she was 14 or 15. She was carrying a baby, and she was pulling this toddler along behind her. And I watched as this girl and her two children walked down the center row of the train, stopping in every row to ask for money, to ask for food, and to ask for help. And I remember watching in every row as people looked away, ignored her, and told her to leave them alone. They didn't want this poor girl and her two children ruining their happy Christmas Eve. And I remember feeling so incredibly angry and so deeply ashamed that there was nothing that I could do for this girl and her children. And I promised myself that night, if I ever had the chance, I would do something for girls like her. Now, what I didn't know about 30 years ago on Christmas Eve was that there are actually 600 million girls like the one on the train. Girls who don't get enough food to eat, girls who don't get to go to school, girls who don't see a doctor when they need one, and girls who live their lives in fear and in silence. $82 million of these girls living in poverty become child brides. Child marriage has been in the news a lot lately, so I'm sure you've heard about it. But it's hard to really imagine what that means and what that looks like. So I'm going to ask you to join me in a thought experiment. Take a moment, close your eyes if you want to, and imagine a girl you know. Imagine a girl that you know. Maybe she's your daughter. Maybe she's a girl in your neighborhood. Maybe she's a girl that you see on your way into the factory. Imagine her at age 12. Imagine, what does she look like? How does her laugh sound? What sports does she like to play? What's her favorite subject in school? What does she want to be when she grows up and becomes a woman? Now imagine that same girl at age 12, married to a 35-year-old man. It's hard to imagine. It hurts to imagine. But that's the reality that we're talking about. The reality of 82 million girls who by economic necessity and desperation are pushed into these early marriages. Where at age 12 or 13, they're married. At age 14 or 15, they have their first child. And if they survive childbirth, which many of them don't, they will go on to have two or three children by the time they're 20. And because these girls don't get to go to school, don't get to learn the skills that they need to actually be part of a workforce and have dignified employment, these girls have no economic power in their relationships or in their communities. And what that means is that these girls can't advocate for themselves or for their children. And their children will go on to live lives that look very much like their own. lives of abuse and violence, poverty and desperation. Sadly, but not surprisingly, when you imagine these realities for girls, suicide is actually the number one cause of death for adolescent girls around the world today. Number two cause is maternal mortality, because these girls are too young to be bearing children. These girls go on to become women whose lives look very similar. Two out of three illiterate adults are women. These women don't have an education, therefore they can't participate fully in the workforce. And for working women, 50% of them fully are in vulnerable forms of employment. What that means is that they're at risk of abuse and exploitation because they don't work for companies that think like you do, that have conferences like this to think about how you can even do more. And they're exposed. And there's no one who's advocating for them. These women, just like all women around the world, this last statistic, is an average globally that women do 2.5 times more unpaid work than men. Mary mentioned this. And what does that mean? That means that women are doing 2.5 times more of the childcare and the cooking and the cleaning. And in poor families, the fetching of the water and the fetching of the wood. And that means that these women have 2.5 less times the amount of time to focus on their career, on going back to school to get a master's degree, on their professional trajectory, and therefore can't participate equally in the workforce. So these are the micro realities facing girls and women. Millions of them every day around the world. What does that translate to, though, at a macro scale? What it translates to is that gender inequality that I'm talking about right now costs the global economy $12 trillion. That's trillion with a T. This is research out of McKinsey showing that because we're not including girls and women fully in development and in these equal opportunities, we are leaving $12 trillion on the table. This is $12 trillion that could be going into improving education for girls and boys, improving health outcomes in poor communities, into infrastructure development, into economic growth. But instead, because we're not having enough of these conversations and there aren't enough companies and organizations out there making these kinds of commitments, this is money that we're leaving on the table. So that's the bad news. I like to start with the bad and get better. The good news, however, is that there are solutions. There's very, very clear evidence and research showing what these solutions are. Every year that a girl goes to secondary school will increase her eventual earnings by up to 20%. Again, that's micro, right? However, when 10% more girls go to school, national GDP goes up by 3%. That's macro. And that is a big deal for all countries, especially countries whose governments are struggling in their own economic growth. I don't have to tell you all about this third bullet because you know it. I know who's on your board and I know who's on your executive team. But the truth is that companies with strong female leadership have a 3% greater return on equity than companies who don't. So again, investing in women and girls is not just the right thing to do, which it is, it's also the smart thing to do. Closing these gender gaps in work would add $28 trillion in GDP by the year 2025. Given this evidence about the incredible dividends of investing in women and girls, it's not surprising that this focus on women and girls has become a critical component of the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. The UN passed the Sustainable Development Goals in 2016. And essentially what the SDGs are is our global roadmap, moving forward in advancing development. The UN engaged government leaders, corporate leaders, decision makers at all level, civil society, in charting the course forward. And what resulted are these 17 goals focused on water and education and environment and gender. And you won't be surprised to know that of the 169 targets associated with these 17 goals, many of them are explicitly focused on women and girls. Because we know that investing in women and girls is what is key to creating exponential change. And that brings us to Rise Up. In 2009, I kept that promise that I made Christmas Eve night 30 years ago to do something for women and girls. And in 2009, I started Rise Up, which activates girls and women to transform their lives, their families, and their countries to create a more just and a more equitable world. I started Rise Up because I have seen in my own life, and the evidence demonstrates, that enabling girls and women to recognize and use and strengthen their own power is the most effective strategy that we have to improve everyone's life. By enabling girls and women to stand up and become part of the workforce and get their educations, that leads to benefits for those women and girls and their families and their communities and the men and boys in their lives. So what does that really look like? To me, it looks like this young woman named Veronica. Veronica is an indigenous young woman from Guatemala who became part of Rise Up in 2009. Now, when we met Veronica, she was living and working in a remote rural village with a group of 20 indigenous girls. Now, realities for girls in Guatemala are difficult, especially for indigenous girls, where in many indigenous communities, less than 10% of indigenous girls finish primary school. And Veronica wanted to do something about that. So she got this group of girls together, created a safe space for them to share their stories and support each other to stay in school and come together when they had struggles so that they could pursue their dreams. And when Veronica came into our program, she participated in Rise Up's Leadership Accelerator, where she learned how to use advocacy and how to use innovation to create much larger scale impact. So the wheel started turning, and she started to think, well, what else could this group of girls do? So with support and funding from us, she enabled these girls to start to advocate for their rights at the local level. They met with local leaders, with the mayor, to support girls' education and girls' health. And over time, this group of girls became a very strong network that was effective in looking at the problems and understanding the challenges that they faced and developing their own strategies. And over time, these girls decided what they really wanted to focus on was bringing an end to these early marriages, which limited girls' ability to stay in school. So Veronica got together, in addition to these girls, other allies in civil society, in government, and started really what became a national movement to end child marriage in Guatemala. And they were so smart about it. They, you know, these girls went on the television and local radio stations and started a dialogue about why investing in girls and women, again, is not just the right thing to do, it's the smart thing to do, and it benefits girls, women, and men, and boys. And over time, they built this momentum, and in August of 2017, the Guatemalan Congress passed a law banning child marriage. So Veronica was able to go from reaching those 20 girls in a village to now having legal protections in place for 2 million Guatemalan girls. That is what exponential change looks like. Every now and then, I am accused of being a bit of a policy wonk. So I am often asked, well, that sounds all good and great and exciting. How does that actually work, and what does that actually mean, and what does it actually look like? So I'm going to get into it for you. We start by identifying these leaders, like Veronica and a few others that I'll introduce to you in a moment. We cast a wide net to find leaders at the local level who are doing great work on a small scale, who are passionate and committed to advancing social justice and improving the lives of women and girls. Sometimes they run a school or a clinic or a safe home for girls. And when they come into our program, they participate in a leadership accelerator where they really learn how to reflect on and strengthen their own leadership and strengthen the work of their organizations. And during this accelerator, they focus on their values, their goals, and they learn strategies of advocacy and innovation to create large-scale change. So by the end of the accelerator, they have a fully baked strategy that they can then go out and implement. We don't stop there, because what we've learned is that training people in this work is not enough, and they need resources. So we have created a social justice fund where leaders who have gone through our accelerator program can apply for funding to launch the strategies that they develop in their communities and in their countries. We fund the best of these strategies and then provide them with ongoing support in implementation, because these are not easy battles that they're fighting. This really is the hardest work in the world. And oftentimes, they'll jump in and hit a wall. And so we support them in navigating that and managing those constraints. So for example, in Guatemala, they really struggled with the role of the Catholic Church and the voice of the Catholic Church and how to engage effectively with the Catholic Church. So we supported them to find local experts who could give them guidance in developing messaging and strategies that could bring the church along as an ally instead of opposition. In addition to funding this work and supporting these leaders, we're building movements. So we keep bringing these leaders back together for opportunities to continue to learn to develop their skills, to continue to support each other, and to become part of these existing country-based movements. Because what we're really talking about is creating a critical mass of advocates and of leaders across sectors, government, corporate, nonprofit, civil society, who are passionate and committed and effective at improving the lives of girls and women. And one thing I really want to point out in listening to the conversation this morning and the importance of engaging men, our focus is on improving the lives of girls and women, but at least one third of our participants and our leaders in our network are men, because we absolutely know that none of this is going to happen if we're not engaging men in the solution. And that all works to transform the lives of girls, women, their families, and their communities. So I live in San Francisco. My husband works in Silicon Valley. And every now and then, I'll be talking to one of his friends and tell them about what I do. And more than once, someone has responded, oh, so you guys are like angel investors for women and girls. And at first, I was like, oh, please. You know, it's so jargony. But actually, I think there's a lot of truth to it, right? What we do is find local leaders and strong local organizations and give them the tools, the training, the funding, the resources, the networks, and the support to go from small-scale local impact to large-scale change. We adapt this model across different political and cultural contexts because these realities for girls and women look really different in each place that we work. So we have a small team in Oakland, where my office is based. And then most of our work is led by in-country nationals in each of the countries where we work. So in the case of Africa, for example, there is a practice known as kusasa fumbi, which is essentially sexual cleansing. And what happens is that when girls hit puberty, they are sent off to an initiation camp where they learn to become women. It's a rite of passage that all girls go through. So they go off to a camp and they spend a couple weeks learning about how to cook, how to clean, and how to please their future husband. The final exam of this camp is when the village pays a man known as the hyena to come in and rape every single one of these girls in the camp. Now, not surprisingly, many of these girls get HIV. Many of them get pregnant. This was a practice I had never heard of before we started working in Malawi in 2010. In 2010, we started working with a young girl named Memory Banda. At the time, she was 13, and she was supposed to go off to one of these camps, but she refused. One of her friends had gone the previous year and come back pregnant, and she didn't want to go. She wanted to stay in school, and her friend had to drop out. So she refused, but her little sister, who was 11, went to the camp and came back pregnant at age 11. Memory decided that she had to do something. So she got together a group of girls and started teaching them how to read and how to write. And over time, this group of girls developed some strength and came together and became part of the Girls Empowerment Network of Malawi, which is an organization that we have partnered with since 2010. Memory and the Girls Empowerment Network launched a campaign called I Will Marry When I Want, where they got 200 girls together and used a methodology called the River of Life, where these girls used art and poetry and all forms of creative expression to talk about what their lives had been and what they hoped for their futures. And through this girl-led process, they decided the biggest challenge that they faced was not being able to stay in school because they had to drop out and get married. So they launched this campaign, I Will Marry When I Want, and what they did was advocate with local village chiefs to pass bylaws, making it so that if a man married a girl under the age of 21, he would have his land taken away and would pay a fee in goats. Sounds a little strange, maybe, here in a conference room in Indiana, but it was incredibly effective. So they managed to get 60 chiefs to pass these bylaws that protected girls' rights, supported them to stay in school, and enabled them to say no to these early marriages. And over time, this girl-led grassroots campaign developed momentum and fed into a national campaign that Rise Up was also supporting, of national advocates that were pushing for a law to ban child marriage at the national level. So there was this amazing snowball effect where these two movements fed each other. And in 2015, Malawi passed a law to ban child marriage and to support girls to stay in school. And really what we're talking about is to support girls to have the right to be a child. That's what we're talking about. So again, that's exponential change. That's Memory and a small group of girls who now have advocated for legislation that protects the rights of 4 million girls in Malawi. Memory is now 19. She's in college in Malawi. She has a TED Talk, you can look it up, with over 1 million views. And she is a global advocate and a powerhouse advocating for girls' rights around the world. Meanwhile, her little sister is 17 and has 3 children and is trying to go back to school. To me, this story of Memory and her sister is so powerful because it demonstrates the potential and the impact of investing in girls and women and the devastating loss and waste of what happens when we don't. In addition to supporting these girls and women to advocate at the local and national level, we also have supported them to advocate for their rights globally. We had funding at one point to support girls and women to advocate specifically on creation of the Sustainable Development Goals to ensure that girls and women's rights were a priority, because the previous set of Millennium Development Goals did not have a strong gender focus. And I will tell you, it's amazing to see what happens when these girls and women stand up on stage from the floor of the UN, as you see here, a young girl from Guatemala, doing a keynote speech with Ban Ki-moon, or there's Memory doing a panel with Chelsea Clinton on girls' education and child marriage. It is amazing to see not only how these girls and women have such power in sharing their story and how they can take that back to continue to create changes locally. But it's also, I think, even more surprising to see what happens in the minds and in the hearts of global decision makers when these girls and women have the space to tell their stories. Because the truth is, most of the time, global leaders are not thinking about girls and women at all, in any way, shape, or form. And when they do, rarely, it's that they get raped, they get beat up, they're essentially a problem, a burden on the healthcare system. But when these girls and women stand up, these leaders start to see that despite the amazing and huge obstacles that they're facing, these girls and women are not victims. These girls and women are leaders, and they are amazing agents of change. And if we can invest in these girls and women, they will develop solutions far beyond anything that the rest of us can imagine. One last story to share with you. This is a young woman named Gayatri, who is from India, who participated in one of our leadership accelerators in 2014. That had the same focus on leadership and advocacy, and also had a strong focus on technology and enabling young leaders, both young men and young women, to use technology to improve the health of young people in their communities. So when Gayatri came into our program, she had been working on a web-based platform that provided young people with information about love, healthy relationships, and gender-based violence. And during the Leadership Accelerator, what she realized is that she could use technology differently to vastly expand the scope of her impact. So she launched a pilot using WhatsApp, where every week these young people would receive three messages about love and relationships and what to do if they were experiencing violence. And this WhatsApp pilot expanded over time. So it began with some small support and seed grant funding from us, and they've now been able to scale it up with funding directly from the Packard Foundation and are reaching 1.5 million young people every single month. But of course, Gayatri didn't want to stop there. So most recently, I had the chance to interview her about her latest project, which is using virtual reality. So that funny picture of the person looking through those virtual reality goggles. What she said to me was that she realized that in India, the biggest problem is that people don't really understand or have a nuanced idea of what violence really looks like. And I think this is true in most places, right? We think of violence as the guy beats up his wife or his girlfriend. Her point is that it actually starts in much more subtle and hard to understand ways of coercion and manipulation and control. And she felt that for India to actually make real change on this issue, people had to start to understand what that looked like and have a conversation about it. Right? Tony said it this morning, if we can't talk about these issues, we can't actually change anything. So she created this film where when you watch it, you are Anuja, a young woman in India who's dating a guy who doesn't like it when she goes out with her friends and is kind of controlling about how she uses her money. And it starts to, you start to see through the eyes of Anuja what that violence looks like and how it grows over time. And they used this film in pop-ups in subway stations in New Delhi. So they decided, obviously, it's not enough to create a film. And they created these pop-ups where, at rush hour, they would have people stop and have the chance to view this film and become part of a dialogue and part of a conversation about where does violence really begin and what do we need to do to tackle it at its roots. Again, this is what exponential change looks like. We now have a network of over 500 leaders around the world who have directly reached 7 million girls and women and who have advocated for over 100 laws and policies impacting 115 million people. We know that because we take monitoring and evaluation really seriously. So we're always looking to learn from our successes and from our failures and what's not working, and continually tweaking our model and our approach to ensure greatest impact in each of the countries where we work. We work with external partners, including the International Center for Research on Women, to actually look concretely at all elements of our programming and continually improve them. Now, to why I'm here today. I came to Indiana for the first time in my whole life about a year ago, and had the chance to meet with Mary Chandler and her team on the corporate responsibility side. And I will tell you that in this past year, it has been very eye-opening to me. I will be honest, I had some biases about what corporate funders might look like. Unconscious or conscious, right? Both of, all of the above. No, I've always worked in the nonprofit sector, and I've worked with foundations, and I understand how that works. And so when Mary approached me, I thought, well, first of all, who are these Cummins people? Because I've never heard of them. And second of all, really, why are they deciding to commit to women and girls? And I will say that through the past year of experience working with many of you, I have been blown away by the level of true and deep commitment at all levels of your organization to improving the lives of women and girls. It's rare. I assume you know this, but there are not very many companies that spend 2 days with their top leadership talking meaningfully and honestly and openly about what diversity and inclusion really need to look like, and being honest about the things that aren't working, and developing solutions to do better. That is not the way things usually work. So for me, it has been an incredible opportunity to learn from your approach in corporate responsibility and learn from the amazing work that's already happening. I had the chance to visit some villages in Fulton in India and learn about the model village work and the support that you're doing with women leaders at the local level. I had the chance to visit some amazing school-based programs in La Pila, in San Luis Potosí, and hear about the diverse focuses of corporate responsibility in each of the countries where you're working. So, as we've launched this partnership, as Mary mentioned, we're going to be working with the leadership teams in Mexico, Nigeria, India, the US, Brazil, and South Africa, rolling out over the course of 3 years. The core program components for this work are an extension of our core elements of our work, bringing together your core values and your strategic priorities. So really focusing on education, social justice, and equal opportunity for women and girls. We'll start with a leadership accelerator in each country. So in Mexico and Nigeria, we've already selected the 18 leaders that will go through the leadership accelerator. And I will tell you, there's an incredible amount of demand and enthusiasm for this programming. I was on a call, actually yesterday morning, with your Nigeria colleagues, going through the 292 applications that we got for the 18 spots of the leaders that we selected yesterday. So there's a lot of opportunity to be able to build on the amazing work that you're already doing and expand the impact of that work. So we'll start with the Leadership Accelerator, support these 18 leaders to strengthen their leadership, their organizations, and learn to think differently, and learn to create strategies that can lead to large-scale change. We'll be funding the best of those strategies through our Social Justice Fund. We'll also be working with these leaders to build that pipeline of girls who are 9, 10, 11, and who are both the leaders of today, and honestly are already the leaders, are the leaders of tomorrow and also today. So in addition, we'll be looking at creating opportunities for these girls and women to share their stories at national and at global levels, whether at the UN General Assembly or in other key convenings, to be able to influence the conversation and the investments around women and girls. Several of you have already been very deeply engaged in this work, advising us on our strategy, so working with Ignacio and his team in Mexico as we launch the call for applications. Likewise with Gino in Nigeria, and really having your teams be part of the selection process and making sure that we are finding the best of those leaders at the local level. Several of you are going to be participating in the accelerators directly, so coming in and doing panels on corporate responsibility, on donor perspectives. Because the reality is most of these local leaders don't ever get to talk to people like you who have a deep commitment to doing this work, but from a very different lens than they have. And so being able to bring your expertise into those conversations is crucial. And as the program moves forward, I'm excited to see what opportunities will arise for you all to engage directly with the leaders in their campaigns and in their advocacy and in their innovations in programming. You all have already played an incredibly critical role in the work that we've set out to do. And I know that over time, those impacts will grow. And I hope, maybe in a couple years, to come back and share some of them with you in a conference like this. In addition to the amazing work that you're doing through this incredibly important new initiative that Cummins is launching, I want to leave you with three things that every single one of you can do in your own life, in your work, and in all the spaces in which you have influence. First is to be a mentor. By virtue of the fact that you are in this room, you are already a leader and you already have influence, far beyond what you probably even realize. And to use that influence to be a mentor and to support a girl or a young woman, whether in your neighborhood or on your factory floor or in one of your teams. Find a young woman who's starting out in her career and ask her what her goals are and how you can support her. You might be amazed by what you find. The second thing you can all do is to be an advocate. Whether you are advocating for gender equity in pay with other corporations that are not nearly as forward-thinking as you are, or whether you're advocating at your kid's school for programming that supports girls' education and sports programs, or you're advocating with the Minister of Finance to support job training programs for women. Be an advocate and recognize both the power and the responsibility that you have. Tony asked earlier, he said, well, do we start big or do we start small? My answer is yes. Both. We start big and we start small. We start at all levels of where we are and who we can influence and in what ways at this moment, because you never know where that will take you. But none of it will happen if you don't start. And the third thing that you can all do is invest. Whether it's $10 or $10,000 to support girls and women's programs, scholarships, and opportunities in the communities that you work makes a huge difference. Now, I'll be honest, usually at this point in the speech, I ask all of you for money. But I'm not gonna do that today because you have already made a huge financial commitment and investment in women and girls, both through your partnership with Rise Up and through the amazing grantee organizations that you all are going to be investing in around the world. I'm not gonna ask you to invest in that way, but I'm an advocate and I never, never miss an opportunity to make an ask. So my ask today is actually going to be even bigger. I ask every single one of you to recognize the power that you have to make a real difference in the life of a girl you know, or in the life of millions of women that you don't know. The truth is that Cummins has a uniquely critical role to play in this space. And I ask you to not hold back from fully using that power. Cummins has an authentic and deep commitment to women and girls. And there is power in authenticity. And what I have seen is that over the years, there were very few folks when I started this work who were concerned about women and girls at all. And a few years ago, Melinda Gates came out and said, you know what? Women and girls need to be at the center of development and the center of our philanthropy. And so at that point, the Gates Foundation started to invest deeply in gender equality in women and girls. You won't be surprised to find out that everybody else followed along. The truth is that Cummins has an opportunity right now to make a difference that is equally significant and maybe even bigger Because the sad reality is that when Melinda Gates stands up and talks about women and girls, she is a leader for so many of us. And there are still people who will say, oh, you know, she's a woman, of course she cares about that. But when Tom Linebarger stands up and says, as the CEO of a Fortune 200 company in an incredibly male-dominated field, when he stands up and says that I personally and my company believe deeply in investing in women and girls, and it's both the right thing to do and the smart thing to do, people will listen. And other companies will follow. Tom said it in the video. Creating an engine is hard. Creating a just world for women and girls is bigger. And I know that together, we can do that. So to close and come full circle, I asked you at the beginning of this talk to imagine what it would look like if you had the power to create exponential change. Look around for a moment. Like, actually look around you. You do have that power right now. This is it. This is what exponential change looks like. Thank you so much.